empty eyes. You're full of Botox to mask your disguise. You say the things no one wants to hear while the sucker next to you is buying you a bag.
We're going to have a little Q&A. And at the risk of sounding redundant, please. Thank you, this is genuine.
Yeah, talking is not just about getting out what you have to say or just talking, but it's also being prepared to listen to what the other person has to say.
Like a Greek philosopher once said, we have two ears and one mouth so that we can listen twice as much as we speak.
That was unfathomably deep.
Talk to me.
Oh, yeah.
That's actually a very good question.
You stay classy, web surfers.
And welcome once again, my puppies, to another informative hour of Let's Talk. I am your host, Michael Old Hip Johnson. And tonight, it is my pleasure to welcome, for the first and I hope not the last time, a gentleman I actually met via R. Gary Patterson. He actually struck my interest over at Pop Odyssey Radio Network. And I'm like, you know what? You interest me. And I'm sure if you're going to interest me, you're going to interest my listeners also. So I'm going to want you all to say hello to my new friend, and I hope he's going to become one of yours, Mr. Andrew Brewer. Hello, Andrew.
Well, Michael, how sweet of you to say all that. Good evening. How are you?
I'm fair to partly cloudy. How about yourself?
It's sunny. I'm sunny, although it's kind of dark, but I'm still sunny. That's good.
And, you know, you just hit my old hip bone, you know, sunny. You know, yesterday my life was filled with gray. Anyway, that's not what we're here for. I have some people in the chat room already. I got Scooby 12 and Lady A saying, hello, Andrew. So, see, you're...
Well, good evening to everyone. I hope they're having a good evening. I hope all is good and rocking and wherever they happen to be.
Well, we have friends from all over the world, so... You know, basically tonight, as I run every Let's Talk show, I let people know that tonight the world is actually yours. We just live in it. I'd like to start off, if you don't mind, you know, where did you actually... Well, I've had many psychics on my show, and it seems like it's a 50-50 split. Do you believe that you are actually special with your psychic gifts, or do you think that it's something that we all have?
When I was younger, I used to be very democratic with it and think that if I had it, anybody had it. But what I found was as I got older and I did it more and more, I realized that I did things that other people didn't seem to do. So I'm inclined to say that there is a difference. So if my only choices are everyone has it or I'm special, I'm going to go with the I'm in a like a special club. But let me clarify that. Everyone has the potential to tap into some intuitive peace within them. What happens with most people is that they're taught that that doesn't exist and there's too much noise and clutter in their personal psychology and in their world for them to really be quiet enough to hear what's going on within them. But all that being said, just like there's some people that are very talented naturally as musicians or athletes or whatever, I think there is a difference. And so for whatever reason, I don't think everyone can do what I do because just over the years of doing it, and I've been doing it off and on as a professional psychic since the 80s, I said I've changed my tune as time goes on, has gone on. In the beginning, yes, I thought if I can do it, anybody can do it. But since then, I've changed. So that's my answer.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense, definitely. Because, I don't know, I've often wondered if it might be because scientists say that we use, what, 10% of our brains? Or is it 90%? I can't remember the exact number. You got to excuse me. There are some times I only have two brain cells left, and they seem to be strangling each other. But I'm just wondering, though, if there's just a part of our brain that might have gone into slumber mode, so to speak.
I mean, it's possible. I mean, there's lots of ways to look at it. What I've done over the course of my life is really try to access ways to be a high achiever in whatever it is that I did. So you could say, in one sense, that a big portion of my lifetime has been devoted towards learning how to be good at things. I was a corporate executive, I was a good athlete, I was a professional actor, the top 100 psychics in the world, all these kinds of things. So I've done different things, and I've tried to understand the mechanics of how to be expansive within myself. So it correlates to what you're saying about the usage of the brain. I do believe that there are ways that some of those dormant parts of the brain we actually can enhance. I think it will make us perhaps more intelligent. Our memory is better. Our cognitive skills across the board will be better in everything. So is psychic ability simply one of those dormant things that if we knew where it was housed and how to activate it, it would be more accessible to more people? I think that's probably true. But even with that, I think that there are predispositions that we have each individually that makes some of us more adaptable, and others in terms of both their genetics and their personalities are perhaps less adaptable, less receptive to those types of changes within themselves. So even with that, I think that most people do not push themselves in order to get better. I think they sort of find the happy medium, if you will, and are content with that, where other people are driven in ways that they will be more exploratory. I was one of those types. So for whatever reason, it was very disruptive to me as a young man. I saw things that confused me a lot. I mean, it confused me a lot. And so I devoted a big portion of my 20s and 30s to trying to understand it. And it was the work that I did. I mean, most people think, you know, you just have it or you don't have it. It's, in my opinion, it doesn't work that way, because it's not so much whether you're psychic or not psychic. You have to understand what to do with it. You have to understand yourself. You have to understand the dynamics of how to work with people. You have to work with your own self-esteem. I mean, there's a lot of things that there's no psychic who's 98% accurate. There's no psychic who's 88% accurate. It's subject to a lot of different things within your own psyche. And you learn about yourself, and you learn ways of detaching from the impediments. And I think the learning curve is not, as I say, is not learning how to be psychic, but what I call decluttering, Michael, which means that you develop ways to eradicate the distractions and to make yourself able to concentrate and be more focused. And you also develop a certain element of self-confidence, and that self-confidence allows you to keep moving forward. And that can't be fake. That comes over time.
And, you know, there's something else that if I may be so bold as to point out, there's also our own self-will. I mean, a psychic could tell you tomorrow, you know, that you're going to be rich, or, you know, a year from now, you're going to be rich and famous. But if your own self-will is against that notion, it's not going to happen.
Well, I mean, that's absolutely true. And when the book and the movie The Secret came out a few years ago, the missing link to that is that if you have a script within yourself that says, well, no matter what, that's not going to happen for me. It doesn't matter how many affirmations. It doesn't matter how many stickers you have in the envelope or how many magnets you have in the refrigerator. None of that matters if within yourself there's an ideology that says, but I don't deserve it. You have to really look at root cause. And so what happens is that people's development, and I do believe that this is partly past life, which kind of puts me in a unique camp, as well as it's early childhood development. But those scripts, those modes of being and modes of seeing yourself, they have tremendous impact in the ways in which we make decisions. So if you look at karma, past lives and karma, my sense of karma is not that it's like a form of retribution. I killed somebody in 1900, they're going to shoot me in 2014. I don't believe it works that way. What I think that karma is really emotional and psychological tendencies that we have that influence the ways in which we process our emotions, that influence the ways in which we make decisions. So, so if you have some internal dialogue that perhaps you're not aware of, or you're not sure who put it there, that's going to more likely than not negate, you know, the fact that, yes, you're going to have a lot of positive things. You have to look at the core of the individual, and that core can be modified, but it can only be modified through intention and recognition of that particular individual. There's nobody that can do it for them, and lots of times, and this includes me, we need help in order to clarify that, get in touch with that, and find ways to make really more positive choices for ourselves.
You know, that I've said for a number of years that I do not believe that love is the greatest power in the universe. I actually seem to think that intent is.
I would agree with that, because what happens is they're linked in one sense. So I mean, we might be in a semantic thing, but I would agree with you. And think of it like this. If where most people get off track is that they try to live out a script that they haven't created, but they've inherited. Dad was a dentist, grandpa was a dentist, great-grandpa is a dentist, my uncle's a dentist, everybody's a dentist. Guess what? I'm being sort of schooled to be a dentist. I don't want to be a dentist. I could care less about being a dentist. I want to be a surfer. I want to do whatever. But my life is only going to be good if I go to dental school. Now, what happens is that when people absorb somebody else's opinion about who they are and they don't really reflect on that for themselves, they're going to be kind of lukewarm in the ways in which they go after it. You know, yeah, sure, I probably should do this, but I mean, you know, I'm kind of like half-assed about it. I don't really care. But if you're in love or really motivated, dude, you're going to go. You're going to be, whew, I'm in love, I'm going to go. I want this so passionately, so badly, nothing's going to stop me. But if I don't really care, yeah, I might make an effort, but, oh, it's raining, I guess I won't do it. I mean, that's the way it works, right? So the intention is what makes it fly. I'm in love with this woman. I want to go meet her. I want to go see her. I want to spend time with her. I want to be a baseball player so badly I'm going to play 24 hours a day, right? So that intention, but it's typically that intention is tied to some driving desire, and that desire can be equated to love. So love may be the spark that sets the intention, but I think it's the drive and the action that really matters more than anything else.
And that's one of the things I've struggled with most of my life, is I have noticed that when I sincerely put my mind to something and I give it my all, 95, 98% of the time, it works itself out. The thing is,
well, you continue with it, Michael. I mean, that's the beauty of it. If you say, I'm not going to quit, yeah, it's going to work out. If I do it and I don't really care, the first thing that doesn't go right, well, I'm done, so it didn't work because I don't stick with it. But if it matters to me, I might have that same initial complication, but that doesn't slow me down. But if I don't care, that initial complication may end it. And so the things that you really, that matter to you, that you put a lot of focus in, a lot of passion in, you're not going to give up. I mean, you have that kind of bulldog kind of vibe, which I think is beautiful. So you're going to keep at it, and that's why that's going to happen 98% of the time.
That's why I consider myself a loser, but never a quitter. I don't know when to stay down.
Well, I mean, Jack Dempsey said a champion is somebody who gets up when he can't. And so, I mean, I think that's the way you have to look at it. I have a term I call the shamanic roto-rooter. And I came up with this term, you know, 6-7 years ago. And it's like the only thing that will outlive me is this term, shamanic roto-rooter. Anyway, the shamanic roto-rooter is like the dark night of the soul. And a lot of us have gone through that. I've certainly gone through that. And when you go through that process, in whatever way that manifests itself in your life, typically that is a reversal. It can be a depression, it can be a loss of a job, a form of grief, it can be all those things, or some of them, it could, whatever it is, it kind of sucks, right? But if you work through that, what typically happens is that if you go through this dark night of the soul, if you go through the shamanic rotor, if you go through these setbacks, and you really believe in yourself, and you believe in life, and you move forward, what you find is that people who have had these reversals, they come out stronger, they come out more balanced, more integrated. So when we look at our histories, we can see something as, oh my gosh, that was like the worst thing that happened to me. Or we can go, you know, at the time that seemed like it was terrible, but in retrospect, what that did was it took me off one path and pointed me onto something else. So it was a disruption, certainly an element of pain to me at the time, but had I not had it, I wouldn't know what I know today. I wouldn't be in the position I am today. Look at all the good things that have come to me as a result. But at the time, dude, it sucked. That sucked a lot. And that's just the way it works. So by saying that you're not a quitter, what you're saying is that you have this persistence. You have this will that no matter what comes up, you're going to get back up off the canvas. You're going to, you know, go to round six. You're going to go to round seven. You're going to keep in the fight. You're going to keep going. And I think that's those people who do that typically have positive results come out of it.
You know, I've been doing, take for instance, I've been doing this radio gig now. I am one of the grandfathers of internet broadcasting. I have had a radio show of one kind or another since 2006. I had a successful radio career, and that was, you know, I was put on another path. And so, but there's one thing, and if I read from your bio on your webpage that you know about radio and you know about TV. But once it gets in your blood, I don't care what kind of job you have, there's nothing like getting behind the microphone. There's just nothing like it. It's like an obsession, lack of a better term. Okay, it's just something that I feel like I was born to do. I feel like I'm a natural born communicator. But there are times, though, where I start thinking, okay, there's other people doing the same thing I'm doing. You know, being an internet broadcaster is not cool anymore. But you know what? I don't do it to be cool. I do it because I happen to love broadcasting. And this, at the current time, is the only way I could do it. Let me think here. Oh, I have somebody in the chat room, care to you, that said, got my piglet face on just for you, Andrew.
Well, that sounds beautiful. I'm happy to hear that. That's fabulous. You know, what you're saying is about passion. It's about love, I mean, basically. And so, I mean, I'm a ham. You know, I guess that's not super surprising after hearing me talk, right? But, I mean, I like to talk. I like to engage with people. I like to share with people. I like to be on stage. But I also like to meet people and get to know them. And you know, you change as a result of that. I think there's an openness to experience or experiences, you know, that makes our lives better. And for me, I found that I also naturally gravitate towards talking. I seem to get, you know, positive feedback from the way I communicate. And it's been a big part of my career in one way or another, either in a corporate setting or as an actor or as a psychic. Certainly talking is a big deal to me. But I think, you know, as we look at whatever our path is, when we find something that matters to us, that we care about, it's good that we have the passion and the wherewithal to maintain that and keep after it. I mean, I think that's beautiful. I've been the host and I've been the guest. Personally, I like being the guest better because I don't like hitting the knobs and unmuting people and doing all that. But I've been in a wide variety as the actual host. I've hosted for, you know, rock stations and things like that, and I was a long time ago the resident morning psychic on a big rock station back before there was an internet. You know, so I've done a lot of different things, and I've been on TV and did a an infomercial and was on television for a couple of years, you know, and been in films as an actor. And, you know, there's a lot of different venues that have come up. And I'm like you. I really do enjoy it. It really is fun.
Well, you know, I just, back to, here's a question for you. When did your, and I guess I'm back to the very start here because I'm not sure if I want to call it a gift, or when did your abilities first present themselves?
So that has a kind of an interesting and quirky answer. You could say they happened when I was very young, you know, pre-kindergarten, 2, 3, 4 years old, and that would actually be a legitimate answer. But when I was conscious of it, I was in my very early 20s. So let me give you why the 3-year-old is a valid answer and why 20 is also a valid answer.
Okay.
So when I was 3 or 4, I had images, visions of being in different places. I was always a soldier. I was in, you know, there are pictures of me as a baby where I have taken my photos and I have drawn on the photo itself a line from the right shoulder across down to the left hip, just like we see in military uniforms where they have that belt that goes across. That's the way I thought that I looked. So to me, that was me. As a little boy, you know, my mom had like Red Book and Good Housekeeping and all those magazines, right? And this was in the 50s. I couldn't read, but I would look through these magazines and I would naturally gravitate to the ads in the back for military schools. I'm like, I would like lust after these, like somebody might lust after a Hot Rod magazine. I wanted to go to military school, like in the worst way, when I was like 3, because it's what seemed right to me. Now, I was a very kind of a prodigy, intellectual prodigy. I mean, I had a really high IQ, you know, I was a very smart child. So, you know, it kind of goes and does its thing. You know, all that stuff passes by the wayside. And then in my early 20s, around 19 or 20, I started having these sort of deja vu kinds of experiences. And it confused me a lot because I promise you, the last thing in the universe I wanted to be was a professional psychic, an amateur psychic, any kind of psychic. I was a jock, pretty boy, fraternity boy. That was my world. You know, get out of my way. I'm having a good time. I don't have time for this. But it had time for me, and it didn't go away. So I think it's been there, and I think that when we're young, you know, little kids, it's in a way. I think we have an opportunity to have those experiences as a child. But by the time I get into around 20, 21, 22, it was full-blown right there. And there was no way to avoid it. And when I was 24... this was in 1979. When I was 24 years old, I went to San Francisco, and I learned things about ways to harness it, and that changed my life. From 24 on, it was the major driving force of my life and never changed. Now, I didn't always, you know, work as a professional psychic or I did other things, but there is a before and after kind of quality to my life before 1979 and after 1979, and it really is about finding ways to harness this wild stallion psychic ability and what to do with it. And I mean, I worked at it. That's been, 34 years. I've continued to work at it and still working at it, trying to get better and better and better. I mean, it's an ongoing process. But in truthfulness, as a child, I also had, you could say I had a near-death experience when I was 2, you know, I mean, I think that that's a legit thing to say in a kind of a weird way. I think that's probably true. So, you know, there's a lot. I hope that makes sense, what I said.
It does, more than you could even imagine, because when you and I first talked on the phone, 2, 3 weeks ago, I felt like an automatic connection with you. It doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. And
I'm like,
well, I mean, it
and so are you. So that was good. I mean, we had a genuine rapport. We got along. We had fun. Mm-hmm. You know, we're each kind of off the wall kind of characters. It was a good thing. Absolutely. So I echo that.
And so I, you know, whenever I was younger, I also was drawn towards the military uniform. You know, and I've had people all my life tell me different things, you know. I had one psychic 20, 30 years ago that referred to me as a natural-born shaman. But then I hate the people that will say or will drop something like that in your lap, but then not elaborate on just what the hell they are talking about. We're going to go ahead and kind of phase into the past life here real quick, because I have never had an issue with past lives. As I told you on the phone when we first talked, it seems to me like it's logical because, you know, if you actually look at the way nature is, everything that we see, everything that we touch, everything that we breathe is recycled. There is nothing new under the sun. That's even biblical. So does it make any kind of logical sense that a loving and a caring Godhead or God figure would create everything around recycling, and then when it comes to the human, to stop? It just doesn't seem logical to me. It doesn't seem that way at all.
Well, I have a similar idea about it. Now, for me, I mean, I was born in 1955. And, you know, when I was a child, no one had ever even heard of reincarnation. I mean, there's a much different intellectual climate now than there was, you know, in the 1960s. And so there wasn't a way, really. I mean, these were ideas that were very foreign to me. I never really considered it. What happened with me that got me interested in it was I would have these flashbacks. I mean, I would have these, like, waking dreams. They would pop on my head. What I do now is controlled. These were sort of intrusive. And I had this thing about old houses. So I had this thing about Victorian houses and old houses. I had an emotional reaction to it. And that emotional reaction is oftentimes indicative of what we call a karmic resonance. So you sort of resonate with it. You sort of vibe with it. So I was vibing with Victorian houses. So I go to California in 1979. I'm trying hard to figure it all out. And so I go to this big psychic fair on the Cow Palace, which is where the San Francisco Warriors used to play basketball. And so I'm looking around for somebody that does past lives. So I find this psychic, whoever it is, past lives. I go, dude, you're my boy. So I sit down, I talk to him, and I say, I have this thing about Victorian houses. My question to him was, is it possible that I lived before? First question, is it possible that I lived before? I'm clueless. I have no idea. Secondly, if so, did I live in a Victorian house? And the next question is, will I get my act together and not be in Crazyville here trying to figure this all out so I can go do something else? I mean, those are kind of my questions. So he answered me like this. He said, well, you were, but in your Victorian life, you were a woman, and kind of a handful. I mean, kind of is what he was saying to me. You had your husband who was trying to be nice to you, and you're kind of, you know, kind of a diva. Totally against my personality, right? So you're kind of a diva to this guy. Well, that's not exactly what he said, but that's really what he was implying. And I'm like, okay, my head's spinning, you know. I'm like, okay. It's kind of funny to me now, but at the time, I mean, it was very life and death, you know, confusing time for me. So then he said to me, and, you know, in the bedside manner way of talking to psychics, this is not what I recommend for a budding psychic to say to a client. Here's exactly what he said to me. Your life is going to be hard. I'm like, dude, can I have my money back? You know, I mean, that's where it's about. Your life is going to be hard. You'll love this. Because you've been a king many times, and there's no kingdom. Again, my head's spinning. I'm going, dude, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? This is what I'm really thinking. So I'm like, oh, okay, sure, yeah, right, whatever. So he goes on and on and on, you know, how I'm here and I'm this and that and something else. and basically that my life's going to be complicated. And he said, because you're going to do what I do. I'm like, dude, there's no freaking way. I don't know what you're doing. I don't know where this is coming from. I don't know why you think I'm a king. I don't know why you think I'm a woman. I don't know what's wrong with you, but I can't do what you do. I have no idea. He goes, oh, yeah, you're going to do what I do. I'm like, no. Perhaps you're not really understanding me. And so, to make a long story sort of long, he said this to me. And his wife, afterwards, I was talking to his wife, he goes, oh, yeah, you'll be doing what we do. You'll be, like, really, she said to me, you'll be, like famous at it. I'm like, no, I don't think so. So this was like a month or so later. In San Francisco in the 1970s, it was a wild, beautiful era in life, right? So you could take classes and everything, and any meditation group ever known to man was in San Francisco at that point. So I ended up taking a class on past life regressions. So I go to this class, know nothing about it, and they do the regression, and I'm like a natural. I mean, I'm like, oh. I mean, I'm like locked in. So they want to volunteer. I'm like, ooh, 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 you know, me, pick me. So I do it. What do? I start describing this thing. What are you? I'm a king. And I describe the place. And this woman was from Austria, and her class goes, oh, well, that's Bavaria you're talking about. That's like southern Germany. I'm like, oh, of course it is, right? So that night, I hope this story's not boring. That night I went home, and
not
I could regress myself. I mean, I had the power and the ability to put myself in super deep states of hypnosis and lead myself through the hypnosis, and I could do it that day. And from that day forward, that was the middle of July in 1979, my life has never been the same. So that's my story.
You know, it's very, very strange because we went into this whenever I first talked to you on the phone a few weeks back. And, you know, I happen to believe that, and I guess this is in my core, that this time around, I'm not actually supposed to be a quote-unquote success. I'm supposed to be the cheerleader cheering on my friends or my loved ones for their happy ever after. And, you know, that makes me a success. You know?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, you have to look at, there is, each of us has a social responsibility. I mean, there is a spiritual interconnectedness between everything. Just as you were saying, we recycle, you know, the tree dies, it's reborn in another way. You know, the squirrel dies, it becomes part of the soil. I mean, all those things happen, right? So we have a spiritual interconnectedness with everything. You know, there's a subatomic kind of connection, but there's also a reciprocal, I need the tree, I have stuff it needs, it has stuff I need, we get along. I need the ocean, I need water, it needs me. I mean, it needs me not to do what I'm doing to it in Japan. I mean, we have a relationship with one another. There is a very intelligent coordination happening here. And I want to play my part within that. I want to be in that loop. Now, getting back to what you just said. So if your modus operandi here is to help others, there's a reciprocal vibe that's going on back and forth here. You're nice to them, they're nice to you. I mean, each cog within that evolutionary cycle is being sustained. So you're able to connect with people. You're learning about yourself in the ways in which you engage with people. You're also learning about yourself because in the ways they engage back with you. You have psychics on the radio, they talk to you, they tell you stuff. You can say, well, that's ridiculous or that's reasonable or whatever. But it's giving you opportunities to learn about yourself and explore yourself and explore where you fit into the big bad universe, right? So I think that by taking this approach that I'm here to serve and I'm here to help grease the wheel for others, I think what you're also doing is giving yourself a really beautiful opportunity to make connections and to learn about yourself. That's what I think. And I hope that makes sense.
It does. Well, I asked you before the show, and so now I'm just going to go ahead and ask you my questions. You asked for my birth date, and so, which I gave to you. And I guess I'm asking about what past lives that I might have had. And also, what do you see for, I mean, as far as this whole radio gig, am I actually going to, quote unquote, be successful? Finally.
So let's go with the past life, because I think that the past life answer or story, because it's a story, it's not an answer, and it's not definitive, and it's not all-inclusive, leads to information about how to answer the second piece of that question. So when you look at people from a past life standpoint, we're going to kind of look under the karmic hood here a little bit. What is it that I do, and how do I do it, and what kinds of information am I looking for, and how do I process that information? So whenever I first talk to someone, I make certain kinds of assumptions that, you know, there's, you know, you kind of pick stuff up, there's a personality. But there's also, to me, this visual that jumps in my head. Are you familiar with the concept of chakras, Michael? Do you know what chakras are? Have you heard this before?
Yes, I have.
Okay, I figured you had. But for those who aren't familiar with the term chakra, chakra is a Sanskrit word for wheel. There's seven, there's different schools of thought, but one primary school of thought that a lot of people adhere to is that there's seven major chakras within the body. They are like energy centers within the body. They start in the groin area, genital area, and work their way up. And there's seven of them. And so what happens is that when I look at someone in my mind, again, I kind of have a picture of them in my head, there's layers of information that are like little visuals that are popping in my head, and one of them is like an outline of the person, and these little wheels light up to me. The wheel that lights up to me for you is your second chakra, so you are in a way like the wounded healer. So we have to look at both halves of that statement, wounded and healer. So do I think that there's something that has caused disruption? Yes. I mean, you told me about your accident, but that's not the wounded part. I mean, that may be a catalyst in one sense for you to develop a certain kind of way, but that's not what I'm referring to. But the healer is what's significant for you. Now, when you look at people from a past life standpoint, as a professional psychic, I make a lot of public predictions, a lot of them, especially about business because it's something I know something about. And so with business or anything else, there's going to be an earthquake or whatever, you can measure that. If I say it's going to happen, if it happens, good. If it doesn't happen, bad. You know, it's, you know, I got one right, I got two wrong, I got three right. You know, you add it up, you take the percentage where you go. It's measurable. It's definitely measurable. With past lives, there's no measure. There's no way to verify it. There's nobody knows the answer. There's no one person alive who knows the story of reincarnation. We can speculate, we can do whatever, but we don't know. But when I look at it, what happens to me is that I see these little movies, these little vignettes. But I also try to understand an overriding what I call thematic buckets, and that's kind of a weird way to describe it. They're kind of like vocational groups, you know. Like with me, if you look under my karmic fig leaf, you're going to see a lot of boys in uniforms and with big swords and riding horses. There's a very strong military energy to me, even though I'm what I am. There's a very strong military energy to me. There's a very strong creative energy. There's a lot of artists, and, you know. When I look at you, the image that's the strongest in you is healer. So your thing is about passion, compassion. I'm trying to be good to people. You have a very strong indigenous kind of vibe, Native American. You have that kind of vibe to me. So you are not necessarily so much at home, in my opinion, in Western culture. You are more, you're sort of, in one sense, don't necessarily blend because you have a more, in a way, a tribal mentality, in a way, and a kind of a relationship to people and the earth that's different than the TikTok go-go thing of 21st century United States. But that healer thing, so let's, again, you had mentioned that other psychics had said that you were a shaman. So how do we interpret that? If I say to you that I see you primarily as a person who is here to engage others and help them eradicate pain, both physical and emotional, and that you have done this over and over and over and over again. How do you feel about that?
To be honest, it's starting to freak me out, Andrew.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
It is, and it's also, it's making sense, too, because of different jobs I used to have and also things I did in the military. It makes...
The most, if I was going to say, I'm going to give you two job descriptions that I think sum up your personality and sort of your karmic, sort of we put them in a blender and here's what we come up with. One, we come up with a Native American sort of witch doctor, and the other is we come up with an Army medic. Now, if you were...
Andrew, excuse me for interrupting. I was a Navy corpsman.
Is that like an Army medic? Only
yes.
In the Navy?
Yes.
Okay. So the way that I would see you is a military, like EMT guy, that you're the one that I just got shot in the head, or, you know, the boat blew up or whatever, and you're trying to patch me back together. I see that image as a profile for you. It seems to me that that's kind of your thing, in a way. So you saying that to me makes sense to me. Now, do I see all, know all? Of course not. But what happens is that there are tendencies, and we try to take these tendencies and make a story out of them. So to me, you're sort of a split between this, you know, Navy medic, whatever the naval term is, and someone who is very much live off the land, live in harmony, I got bit by a snake, and I'm going to suck the venom out. I mean, you have that kind of vibe, too. So each of those, if we think about it, is related to healing, it's related to health, it's related to assisting. And what you're doing is you're putting yourself in danger. It's not like you're at home, you're working in a major hospital, you're a nurse or a doctor or a physician's assistant in, you know, Baltimore, but you're in a military environment. You're in an element of danger. Yeah, I could be in a nice, comfy place, but no, I'm out in the middle of nowhere, and they're shooting arrows at me or whatever, and I'm trying to help. So you're pushing yourself. So you're not content to just kind of chill and get a paycheck, and you're engaging, and you're pushing yourself concurrently. So you could build a case that what's really happening is that you need to be helpful at the same time you feel a compulsion to put yourself at risk in the same ways in which the people that you might be helping might be putting themselves at risk. Again, does that ring true to you? Do you understand why I would say it that way?
Definitely, it does. It rings more true in me. I mean, it's like they had a term back when I was a kid about getting my bell run. My bell has been run, Andrew.
Well, I was a boxer. I know that ringing sometimes is not a pleasant sound.
I'm just kind of shaky right now. It's like...
Right, but I mean, I'm just being facetious here, but I'm trying to be serious with this because it's a serious thing. Because, so what do we have? We have a military energy. You have very strong military energy. You have a very strong healer energy. That's an interesting mixture. You also have a religious vocation kind of energy, which means that you've had lives as a clergyman, you've had lives as a priest, you've had lives as a monk. You had that. So you kind of fit in one of three general food groups, which is typically what happens, is that people, they put themselves in different situations in order to have a different backdrop, in order to have a different set of experiences in which to really learn about themselves. To me, spiritual evolution is about not making the same types of choices, being more self-aware and more conscious of, instead of having just like automatic responses to kind of take the high road and take a you know, that might have really made you mad, and you know, but you don't react. You stop and take a deep breath, and you try to do something that's more positive. So people tend to fit into three or four of these major themes. For you, the primary theme is healer, to me, without a doubt. That is your major signature. The next two that you have are military, soldier, sailor, whatever, mercenary, you have that kind of vibe, warrior. There's a definite warrior energy to you. A healer and a warrior is an interesting mixture. And you also have this spiritual, but in my opinion, you've had multiple, I mean, many, many, many lifetimes in which you have had organized religion as not only your driving force in your life, but it's also your job. I'm a monk, I'm a priest, I'm a, you know, whatever. So you've got, those are the three primary ones. Now, in looking at that, so if we have that as, the reason that you might want to look at past lives, the reason that you might want to explore them, is not a parlor game to go, oh, I was, a, you know, whatever, I was a soldier, I was a king, I was a woman that lived in a Victorian house and was the diva to my husband, but that you want to learn about why you think and act the way that you do. I mean, to me, it's a spiritual thing. You know, me feeling this strong sense of reincarnation as a truth, as a spiritual truth, changes the way I look at organized religion. It changes the way I look at decisions I make. It's a very important piece of how I view my life. But whether you have that spiritual epiphany or not, what's the practical benefit, if there is one, of looking at past lives? And to me, the practical benefit is about being able to understand how we respond to things emotionally. Now, if it were true that you fit into each of these three major categories and, you know, one flavor or another, I'm a half a pound of this and 2 pounds of that and a quarter pound of this one, and the next lifetime I'm 3 pounds of one and none of the other two, and I mean, it kind of works that way. So this religious, spiritual vocation part of you would suggest to me that there's a very strong, I need to figure out why the grass is green and if Jesus is true and what to do and, you know, should I be a Baptist or a Presbyterian or, you know, what should I be? To me, those types of questions would be more problematic for you than they would somebody else because you're not going to take them at face value, but I would think that they're significant to you and kind of take a big part of your time. Now, that's a yes or no question. Is that true?
Oh, wow. It most definitely is true. I look back on my different jobs besides being a communicator. I've also always been in the helping field. I used to work in a homeless shelter. I've always been one to want to try to help somebody. And, you know, if push ever came to shove, somebody I truly cared about, I would, in a heartbeat, lay my life down for them.
See, you have a combination of healer, monk, and warrior, just what you just said. So that those three added together, you're hitting from each food group. And so what happens is that life is very complicated. We don't have just, you know, four or five different types of people. Each person is unique. They're a whole microcosm in and of themselves. They're a whole universe in and of themselves. And there's complexity in every interchange that happens between any other person, you know, if you really, other than you just walk past them on the street, right? So understanding who we are, what matters to us, again, going back to this thing that we talked about earlier about love and intention. What matters to me, what's important to me, and what have I been passionate about in the past? This passion in the past might give me some clue about things that might be easy for me in this lifetime. I'll give you an example. I'm a TV psychic, bad boy, poet, wild child. You know, I'm whatever. In my early 40s, I decide I'm going to make money. Because I have a baby, I have a young child, I need to make money. I quit being a psychic. I said, you know, it's probably not so good for my daughter. We live in the suburbs in Ohio. It's probably not so good for my daughter to have daddy be on TV 24 hours a day as a psychic. That might confuse the kindergartners. What can daddy do between now and kindergarten to have a normal life? Daddy goes and starts working in business. But the irony of this is I have no background in business. But within 2 years, I was making $200,000 to $300,000 a year as a business analyst because I was able, and who can understand it, but I was able to learn on the fly. This is in the dot-com era, which gave me the opportunity to get my foot in the door. But once I got my foot in the door, I had natural abilities that who knew where they came from. To me, they're past life skills that I just happened to tap into. I had a natural ability for a lot of different things, and once I went in that door and sort of wandered around a little bit and kind of got used to the, you know, the furniture and where the lamps were and what everything was called, once I went through that initial learning curve, then my natural instincts took over, and I was like, whoosh, you know, like a rocket ship. Now, each of us, that's my haunted clock. It's 8 minutes fast, 52 minutes slow. It's a whole other story. But it says it's 10 o'clock, but it's going to ring nine times. So, you know, it's haunted. So, anyway, that's how past lives work. So I hope that makes sense.
It does. And I've got a bunch of questions here. I know that we have not actually looked at my future just yet. I got a lot of questions here, and if it's okay with you, I've told them I would ask the question before we shut down.
Absolutely.
If that means we have to go over a little bit, so be it. I'm in charge.
There you go. Be assertive. You're a warrior. That's the way it should be.
Yes, yes. I'm just sitting here. You know, I've had a lot of quote-unquote psychics on. And a lot of them, there's some that I do believe. There's others that I've, I have a packed question, which I'm not going to ask you because, sir, you've actually blown away any kind of doubts I may have had. But my packed question to these people have always been, am I going to see my grandfather anytime soon?
Here's my answer to that. I have the standard response. I'm not a medium. I'm an extra large. I don't like to be a medium. I don't like to try to connect with Aunt Petunia because I don't think she's sitting there waiting by the, you know, the bat phone for some medium to call her. Because I think that Aunt Petunia has already long since gone off someplace else. So I'm going to kind of give you my answer to that statement. I believe that everything is holographic. So if we look at a hologram, it's metaphorically a pretty good indicator of what's really happening, right? So the hologram piece, you can, you know, everything is within the, you slice it and it's all replicates and it's all there and it's all a pretty fascinating thing, right? So if we really understood quantum physics, we would understand reincarnation. We would understand how these things work. I believe as a psychic, I am probably, this is kind of a horn-tooting thing, I'm probably one of the very best remote viewers in the world. And I think that's a statement of fact. Because I have described places and details and walked down the street. And I did a thing for a woman, and she got in trouble because her boyfriend thought that she was spying on her because I described how to get to her house, and he thought that he followed her home. And he lived like 60 miles away. So the reason I'm bringing this up is that I think there is like this grid that we tap into, that there's information kind of outside of us. I mean, wireless communication in a way is kind of a good analogy for how this works, as well as a hologram for talking to your grandmother. And so I think that what happens is that consciousness doesn't have to be located within us. It could be that the brain is like the radio, but the actual consciousness is outside, just like you're in broadcasting. You know, you have a signal, you pick it up. Part of being a psychic is having a good radio receiver and being able to tune into the right channel. And like when you and I were young, we'd drive around and had AM radios, we're trying to get, you know, punk and we're getting country, and, you know, we're trying to, we have to drive under the bridge or whatever and sit there until the song's over because we drive, you know, two blocks, we get some other station. I mean, a lot of being a psychic is simply being able to fine-tune and tune into the right station. Anyway, getting back to will you meet your grandfather? I think it's important to really look at, in a generic sense, what is it that we're trying to connect with? Are we trying to connect like in a direct, you know, hi, grandfather, I'm just calling you, checking, and he's not on the other end of the line. There is some there is some essence, like secondhand smoke of him, that we may be able to connect with. And there's a parable of the blind man and the elephant, you know, where you got five guys, and they got blindfolds, and they're talking to an elephant, and one describes it this way, because he's got the trunk, and the other one's got his leg, and it's like, makes a description. Another one's got his tail. Another one's holding his ears. They're all saying, they're all looking at an elephant. I mean, they're all connecting to an elephant. Everything they say is legit. They're saying five different things, right? Because of our perspective and where we happen to be standing in relationship to that elephant. Same thing with your grandfather. Now, I don't like to be a medium because I think it sets up an artificial emotional response, because if Aunt Petunia, then it matters, but if Andy Brewer says it, well, who cares? But if Andy Brewer says it and he's channeling Aunt Petunia, well, then it's an emotional charge and it's more significant. I think that's a kind of an artificial thing to do for whatever reason, but that's just me. Now, what is it that we connect with? We do not connect directly. There's no medium that connects directly with whoever. It's not like I have like the bat phone or some giant, you know, two cans and a string to heaven. It doesn't work that way. So I'm trying to pick up information, just like with your past lives. I get these little images. I got to try to make sense out of it. Who put these images out there? What channel? How come I have cable and I can see it and you can't? I mean, there's a lot of questions that we could ask ourselves and might not have an absolute answer. But again, long story, only sort of long, I think what matters is how you process that emotion. So if you are able to visualize and connect within yourself, I think that supersedes anything I can do for you, anything any other medium or psychic or any other, you know, form of mystical arts type of person can do for you. If I'm your answer, then you're out of luck.
Yeah, that's why.
It has to be a collaboration, right?
Right, and you know,
I mean, I'm not talking about that with anything, not just in this particular case. I mean, I'm not talking about you specifically either, Michael, but really in a generic sense. People, I can help maybe help you, you know, it's a needle in a haystack. I can make the haystack smaller. That I can do. But I can't make you pick up that needle and do anything with it. That, again, goes to intention, and that goes into the way in which you process. If I help shine a light on it, that's fabulous, but you've got to do something with it. You know, I can shine a light on it, and you can read the book, and still it makes no sense to you, right?
Yeah, and that goes along, too. I remember reading Jonathan Edwards. Well, I actually only read somebody one time because it's so easy for it to become a crutch. And, you know, you kind of lose your own personal responsibility if you go running to your quote-unquote psychic every time you turn around.
You know, I mean, I think it's important to look at what it is, what does a psychic do and why, okay? Some people think, I mean, each of us have different styles. And I've gone through different flavors over the years, too. You know, I tend to, you know, sometimes be very much about predictions, sometimes not so much. Now I'm in a mood where I don't really do predictions so much. I'm sort of drifting away from being a psychic in a lot of ways. Because there's a different set of expectations that happens outside of you, and a different set of emotional drivers going on within me, right? You know, I mean, just like with you, you're evolving, and as I evolve, remember, I'm not a static thing just as you're not a static thing. So the psychic themselves, they're going through their own personal evolution, right? So the moral of the story is that when people go to psychics, sometimes they have a preconception of what that's going to be, and that's understandable. They're a consumer. They think they're buying, you know, strawberry ice cream, and they come back with a box of crackers. It's going to annoy them, right? Understandable. But some people respond well to ice cream. Others like crackers. And so there are different styles that different psychics have about the ways that they do things, about the ways in which they process information. Again, the blind man and the elephant parable here, that holds true for psychics. I'm more of an emotional type of intuitive, which means that I'm pretty good at tapping into people's emotional state. I sort of, and when I say I feel their pain, I really kind of mean that in the most literal way. And as a result of that, I can take those emotions and make up a story about what I think is going to happen in a way like an actor might prepare for a role. In a way, that analogy is actually kind of comparable to actually what I do. Somebody else may be all about predictions. You don't even talk to them. They just go, you're going to do this, 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 and this is going to happen. Sometimes I do that, sometimes I don't. It depends on the person, because you can't be one size fits all, because the people coming to you are not just one size. So you don't want to have a formulaic response to them, because some people it'll work with and some people it won't. You have to be receptive and open to the needs and the personality of that particular person. And that particular person is going to be in their own evolutionary state. One day they're happy, one day they're miserable. And I talk to them on the happy day, and I talk to them on the miserable day. And just like your friends, when they're happy, you treat them one way, and when they're sad, you act a different way. It's the same thing with us. We have to be receptive to the emotional state of the person. We have to care about them, and we have to try to be conscious of what their needs are, whatever that is, and do our best. So sometimes you are really helpful, sometimes you're not as helpful, and you have, but always it has to be generated from a sense of love for that person. You have to love them. You can't fake that. You have to really, truly have a compassion and a desire to make them happier than when they came. I'm really, really good at taking people that are really, really upset, and when they get off the phone, they're calmer. That's a skill that I have, and it's partly part of my voice, you know, rhythm, whatever. But that doesn't mean I can do everything, but that just happens to be one thing I am good at. Maybe there's other things I'm not so good at. You know, certain, you know, yes-no types of questions, I'm not, you know, it's kind of not my thing. You know, so there are different people that, you know, are better at different types of things, and God, that's why the universe is big, and, you know, that whole speech. So, go into your future. Now, it's already, you know, at the end of the hour. But if you have a so point me in the direction that you want to go, and I'll try to turn my magic eight ball on, and we'll see what comes out the other side.
I guess, first off, I want to make this observation real quick. You heard it first here on Let's Talk. Beware of cookie-cutter psychics.
Well, I mean, that's true. I mean, just like anything else, I mean, I think that, I mean, Michael, think of it like this. If I go to a tailor and he only has two sizes, you know, I mean, he only has like two ways of doing it, and you have an atypical body, that suit's going to suck a lot. It's not going to fit. So I have to be able to say, well, you got really long arms and a really skinny waist, and, you know, this is going to be a little complicated for me, but I'm going to make it happen. And so I think the same kind of thing has to happen as a...
Yeah, we're still here. Andrew?
Yeah. Something happened. I thought the phone...
No, it's the gremlins. It happens from time to time.
Gremlins? They scare me.
Yes. Hey, so, one time I actually brought up the name of Aleister Crowley, and my whole system shut down. So
he wouldn't be the one I would invite home.
No. So carry on, please.
So, all that being said, yes, I think that you want to, like, I don't, like, if I do radio shows and do call-in readings, which I used to do those all the time, I don't do them so much anymore. But, you know, there's a theme typically that happens, like, everybody has the same type of question. It's fascinating that it always works out that way. They're all relationship issues or job issues or self-esteem issues. They've all had, you know, all sorts of crazy common experiences. It's interesting how it all works. It's like women that menstruate, you know, and they live together. They live in the same time. They get in the same cycle. So
yeah.
The shows have their own sort of rhythm to them. They have their own sort of dynamic. But I think it's important to not prejudge people, to be open to what's going on. Like, the way I would talk to you might not be the way I would talk to somebody else because they have a different personality. You know, you want to be kind of, you want to talk to them in a way that makes sense to them. Somebody else, you know, I might not be able to talk to them in the same way. I have even have kind of a different voice. I'd have a different, certainly have a different cadence. I'd have a different rhythm, a different speed. And that's just me. But I think that's important. I think it is important to be responsive to the emotional state in which that person comes to you and to be reflective of that and compassionate and try Hippocratic oath, do no harm. A lot of psychics do a lot of damage. Let's be honest. A lot of psychics suck. They're dangerous. They have no business doing it, and they don't care.
Sylvia Brown. Oops, did I say that out loud?
Well, I mean, I don't know about Sylvia Brown. I mean, I don't know her, you know, and I won't say that about any one particular person. But it's a byproduct of this particular profession. I've known a lot of people that had bad attitudes. They did not like people. They don't like people. If I don't like people, being in a people business, it's not a good choice. If I don't care about myself, I got dysfunction galore. I mean, I got my own issues, let's be honest. I mean, we all have our own issues. But if I'm just a walking dysfunction, then I'm probably not super helpful to somebody else. So not only are psychics, you know, beware of cookie cutter psychics, another thing I would say is beware of psychics who don't like themselves. You know, that may not always be so easy to see, but it comes out in the wash. So a lot of psychics I think are dangerous. And that's an opinion. Do I know that as an absolute? Somebody could say that about me because I make predictions. I made a lot of predictions where I predicted earthquakes. Most of those earthquakes happened, you know. And what happened is because I was predicting earthquakes and they seemed to be happening as I was predicting them, you'll love this. People began telling me that if I didn't predict the earthquakes, there wouldn't be these earthquakes. I'm like, dude, what planet are you on? I'm not making the earthquake happen. Just as when I talked about the housing crisis that was going to come, I didn't go and pull the house, you know, prices down personally. I was just talking about something I thought was likely to happen. I didn't make the economy. I didn't break the economy. And me talking about it didn't make it happen. And me talking about earthquakes didn't make the earth shake. But some people said that to me. I need to think positive. That's a whole nother speech. Anyway, getting back to the cookie-cutter psychic, I think it is important to, on my end of the equation, to be compassionate and also to say, hey, you know, this is my opinion. I don't claim to know all, be all. I don't have an email from Jesus that tells me what's happening that day. I mean, I don't have a, you know, access code to the future. I mean, I'm pretty good at what I do. I mean, I do think that that's true, but I mean, there's only so much we can do. And I think it's important for people to own their own stuff and for me to be a collaborator, but not, you know, the ringleader. So, again, Michael and the Magic 8 Ball, what do you want to look at? And I'll do my best to really focus on doing that.
You know what? I'm going to go ahead and hold true to my own bell ringing here. Because I want to go ahead and get some of these questions answered. And maybe I'll send you a Facebook mail, and we can go from there. Because I feel kind of guilty that maybe I've taken a lot of this for me.
Well, I'm
stuff.
A long-winded character, what can you say?
You know, and I actually, this is supposed to be a interactive, and it's just Old Hip talking. So Old Hip's going to shut up, and he's just going to ask some of these questions that have come through.
Okay.
Care to You says, I wonder, if we have reincarnated multiple times, I wonder if at some point part of our lesson is to be on the opposite perspective of where we have been. As someone who is repeatedly a caregiver, healer, eventually will become one who needs care.
So let me give you my answer to that. And it goes back to something that I talked about a little earlier, is that we have different sets of experiences in order to give us different opportunities to process emotions because we're responding to different stimuli. That's one way of saying that, yes, I think that that's true. That, okay, so maybe in one life I'm a general and in the Army. Next life I'm, you know, housewife. Those are two very different kinds of things, right? There are different power structure. There's a lot of different things to them. And so in having those experiences, if we have a tendency to act in a certain way as a military officer, maybe that tendency is supportive and valuable. As a housewife, maybe it's not. And so if I'm in a situation in which that particular tendency or style of behavior is appropriate, then it will be applauded and magnified and it will be useful. If it's inappropriate, then it's my opportunity to learn a new way of adaptation. So, yes, I don't know if it is necessarily literally that way. It may be, but certainly we have different types of experiences. We have certain styles that I think are the same. I believe we have a certain kind of predisposition. I mean, we sort of have same personality types, same kinds of things. But just like an actor who might be King Lear one day and play in a comedy the next, I mean, it's still, you know, Matt Damon, but he's acting in a different way, so his personality traits come out differently. He looks different, acts different, you know, whatever. I don't think we just do the same thing over and over and over, because really, what does that do for you? If there is a purpose to it, my opinion, again, not that I'm, you know, I have the direct pipeline to God, and he's telling me and no one else, right? No, it's my theory, and based on whatever it is I see, but it's still a theory. But my theory is that there is a purpose to life, and that our purpose, sort of the reason that we might reincarnate, is to give us opportunities to learn about ourselves. And I don't think we would learn about ourselves as quickly if we did the same thing over and over. I hope that answers that question.
Good answer. You know, it's really odd that we keep going back to stuff that we talked about on our first phone call together. And
that's
I remember asking you about whether people actually choose what life they're going to reincarnate in, as such as, you know, and the example I used was Hitler. You know, was that a choice? Because, you know, I believe that experience is the biggest lesson, you know, or the best teacher is experience. And I also believe in balance. I'm a Libra, so what do you expect? And it just seems to me, again, being logical, that if you've gone through your different lives as being just and caring, well, I believe you also have to go through a life or lives where, let's face it, you're one mean son of a bitch.
Well, I mean, I'm a pretty nice guy, but yet when I was a film actor, I was always a Russian killer, FBI agent. That's the way they saw me, right? They saw me as a badass. I mean, I shaved head. That's the way they looked at me. When I was young, when I was an actor, I was always the suicidal, sweet, neurotic artist. Now, I was just telling someone this the other day, I go, now I'm the father that they were afraid of, and that made him, you know, neurotic to begin with. So, I mean, it's interesting how, you know, we evolve. If you, again, if you look at my primary past life signature, you're going to see a lot of military officers. And these were not all like, you know, roses and bliss 24 hours a day. I mean, they, because of their job description, there's certain things that they had to be. I mean, you know, I was an athlete, I was a boxer, I was all of these things. You know, there's a certain kind of style that we have. So maybe tempering that in some way to do what I do now is important for me. Maybe, you know, being an Army officer might not have been the optimal way for me to evolve. And getting back to Hitler, we could also say that not only was it that person was dealing with a lot of stuff, but that in a social setting, his actions and collaboration with other people, good or bad, gave a lot of people opportunities to have certain types of experiences that they would not have had in a different, you know, without him. Now, I certainly don't condone it. What I'm saying is that I believe there's a reason for it, and it's not for me. I mean, who am I? It's not for me to say anything's good or bad. I say some things I like better than others. I mean, I can say this makes me happy, that kind of annoys me. But I'm not in a position to say black and white, this is evil, this is good. It's beyond my capacity to make those types of pronouncements. And I believe it's beyond anyone's capacity to make those types of pronouncements. Do I think he was a good guy? No, of course not. Am I happy he was here? Well, hell no, of course not. Do I think that there was a purpose to it that is perhaps beyond my powers of perception? I believe there probably is, but I'm not smart enough to know what that would be. But I'm at least open to the idea that there is a reason for it that might not be just plain right in front of me.
And I agree. I have to 100% agree. Lady A has asked, have you met somebody from the past?
Have I met somebody? You mean like have I met people that I thought that I had past lives with? Or have I walked into somebody and it was actually 1837? I mean, those are two different questions. But if the thing is, do I think that I've met people that I've met in previous lifetimes? Absolutely. I'll tell you something else. You all will like this. If you give me somebody's birthday and you give me somebody else's birthday and I look at them, I can tell you with a fairly high degree of confidence whether I believe that there is a karmic connection, yes or no. Am I right all the time? Well, I don't know. But can I build a pretty strong case? And on top of that, to support the yay or nay part of that statement, usually the way I describe the likely way in which that relationship will unfold, more often than not, it unfolds the way I suggest that it's likely to. I do believe that there is an astrological signature that astrology rocks. I mean, astrology tells all, but we're not smart enough to understand what astrology tells us. I mean, we're finite beings. Astrology is part of a cosmic, you know, structure somebody came up with. A whole lot more going on than I am. Anyway, astrology, I can look at, compare charts, what's called synastry, and I'm like on it. I mean, I'm very good, I believe, I do believe this is true, at saying yes or no. Do I think that I have met people that I have karmic connections with? Yes. Have I been in contact with old girlfriends, stuff that I think were past life lovers? Yes. And I've had visions of those. I go, well, we're in Slovenia or wherever, you know. And there are certain people I feel very, like, predisposed to, and others I'm just totally whatever. And so if the question, Lady A, is have I met people that I feel I have a karmic connection with, like I've known them from some previous lifetime, the answer is yes. Am I conscious of that? sometimes I am. I hope that answers her question. I hope that's the question she's asking, too.
Yeah, she's here saying yes, so I'm assuming that is affirmative. And, you threw out a challenge there, so I'm going to go ahead and give you a birth date here real quick. December 25th, 1997.
Well, I mean, I'd have to compare.
Okay.
it's a little more complicated because I have to eyeball it. So it takes a few. I mean, what you have to do is you have to actually construct it. It would take, it'd take at least 5 minutes to do it. Now, I could do it in 5 minutes, but if you want to sit and wait for me, I don't think that makes good radio.
No, and you're right. You're right, and I should have thought about that before I said it.
But what happens is, let me explain how I would do it. So you would look at two birth charts, and there is each planet has a fixed position. It's like when you come out of the womb, you have like a Polaroid, and you take a picture of the sky. And they're all scattered around. You know, Jupiter's here, Uranus is there, the moon's over here. It's all scattered. And what happens is we can graph where they're at. So let's say when I was born, the sun was at 17 degrees Aquarius, the moon was at 13 degrees Leo, Jupiter and Uranus were conjunct right next to each other in the sky in the planet of Cancer, in the sign of Cancer, and so on and so forth. The numbers that I read off to you, 13 Leo, 17 Aquarius, 22 and 24 Cancer, those things are significant because the mathematical relationship between planets, where they happened parked in the sky when you were born, and where the ones parked in the sky when I was born, I can do a mathematical harmonic between the two. And it's the tightness and the mathematical precision in comparing the two of them that they happen to be in the same place at different times. They just circle back around and end up in the same place or in harmony with each other. A mathematical harmony, that's how you tell. It's a little more complicated than that, but that's the essence of it. And then it's like the Far Side cartoon, and then a miracle happens, and then I just figure it out. But astrology is a pretty good indicator. And if I had them and I had time to look at them again, 2 or 3 minutes, it'd take me a few minutes because for one thing, I have to be able. You have to visually. I'm 58 years old. It's hard for me to like go back and forth. I can't see anymore. I gotta have my glasses and all that stuff. So I need to write them down, so I can actually look at them and compare them. So the writing them down, because I can't do it on the computer because my eyeballs are not going to work that way, it's the writing them down and looking at them that way that's actually going to take the time. Once I have them written down, I could do it in 2 seconds. So if you had the charts and handed them to me, I could do them right now. But for me to go find the charts and look them up and write them down and look at them, that's going to take some time. That's where the time element comes in.
Well, I apologize for throwing that curveball at you. That happens to be my daughter's birth date, and her and I are like oil and water anymore. but she's 15 going on 30, so what do I expect?
15 is a dangerous age. I had one, but my daughter was really cool when she was 15. That's part of nature. I mean, that time period in a young girl's life is a time when there's, a lot of changes happening. So that's understandable.
And I got
cycles through.
And I got to throw this out here too. It's very funny you're bringing up about the Native American. My daughter's first love, and they've been together for 2 years. They met online, and he actually talked his parents into driving 40 plus hours from Saskatchewan, Canada, here to meet her. He is actually Cree Indian.
Oh, fabulous.
And now I understand 15 is a young age, but there is nothing. I have no doubt in my mind that my little girl is head over heels in love with this boy. And I find it just to be extremely, just blows my mind that you brought up about the Native American. And here
I went Native American. I'm going to say that that's a literal statement of fact, and it's also sort of metaphorically, it's like a good symbol. Again, it's sort of a blend. If we put them all in a blender, we come up with, if I put green and blue and purple in the blender, what do I come up with? I mean, this is what I come up with.
Right.
So I think it's both a literal statement and sort of a hodgepodge generic stereotype. I think it's both.
Okay, and I have a question here from my buddy Whippy. He is actually from my state of South Carolina. And he said he'd like to ask what Andrew feels about the idea that some people may have lived concurrent past lives.
Well, I'm writing a book on that called Cases with Anomalous Dates. So, dude, we're on the same page with that because I believe that that's literally the truth. Now, I don't believe that past lives are as straightforward as people might think they would be. I do think they sort of blend and cross-pollinate, and I do think they overlap, and I do think there are people. I don't think this is for everybody, but I do believe that some people split. I'm actually writing this book called Cases with Anomalous Dates, which is that very concept. The title of this book comes from a statement made by a guy by the name of Dr. Ian Stevenson, who studied reincarnation. He was the head of the psychiatry department at the University of Virginia. Anyway, he was an academic in psychiatry or psychology at the University of Virginia, a really beautiful school there in Charlottesville. And he studied reincarnation. God, this was eons ago in the 50s and 60s and started. And what he did was he went and he got stories of children that said, you know, I remember living in the next village and my name was, you know, Oscar, and now my name is Tommy, but most of these were like, you know, children from India and different places, right, where there was a culture that supported it. If the culture in the United States had supported it, I would have been those little boys that they did the stories with, right? But, you know, when I said that stuff, they're just like, oh, yeah, he's so creative, right? So, anyway, he found sometimes that, you know, the child talked about another lifetime. But let's say that that child was born in 1960, but the lifetime he's talking about didn't die until 1961. He called those anomalous dates. So those were cases with anomalous dates, where literally the new incarnation ran concurrently with the old incarnation. I believe that happens. I believe my book will be really entertaining, by the way. And I've written books in the past. I'm going to take a little aside here. And I read them, go, that's fabulous. But I read this book and I go, wow. I mean, I'm not joking. I read my own book and go, wow, that's some crazy stuff, man. Who would have thought of that? Because it's like I'm channeling this book in one sense. It's like, who knows where things come from. But I reread my own book and go, wow, I can't say that. So I shelved this book for a year. I had to kind of grow into what I was talking about. So, again, long story short, yes, I believe it's possible. I believe it happens. I believe I literally am one of the people that does that. I do believe that. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Okay.
So I think that, so think of it like this. There's an essence, a soul essence. It may, you know, like a seed pod that might split or whatever, or twins, or, you know, any number of things. Why does the egg and the spermie and, you know, I mean, why do these things happen in a certain way? I think that there are atypical things that happen. And the reason, again, from a purposeful standpoint, what's driving it is that I think that a particular spirit, soul essence, whatever you want to call it, wants to experience things, have a lot of experiences, and they say, you know, hey, this is going to be like World War II. This is going to be a really interesting time. I want to soak up as many different flavors of this as I can. I'm going to come three different times and be in three different places, and away we go. So that's my answer to that one.
Okay.
So, yes, I absolutely think it's true. A lot of people that might be open to reincarnation say that's crazy, but it's no crazier than reincarnation. It's no crazier to me that there is something, if there's something that comes back once over and over, it's no crazier that that is connected to some sort of soul. And again, I'm not smart enough to understand the mechanics of it, but what I call a soul essence. And that soul essence might be like what other people have termed an oversoul, or there are any number of iterations of what that might be. But I do believe that that's how it actually works. Again, Does Jesus personally come and coach me on this? No. This is my theory. But there are a lot of reasons, in terms of my own personal experience, in which that's, you know, I've thought about this for a long time. I didn't come up to this, you know, the first day. I mean, this took years and years and years of going back and forth. But that's what makes the most sense to me based on observation over the years. So I think it is true. And there are other historical schools of thought in the Kabbalah and Sufism and different places in which that's also, they also talk about the same thing. So I'm not the first person to have said it. If I was the first person to have said it, I might be a little more skeptical myself. And I tend to be really good at not paying attention. I don't care what anybody else says. I don't care what psychics predict. Somebody says so-and-so predicted. I'm like I'm going to care. I mean, I'm that arrogant, I guess, that I don't care what anybody said or predicted. It's irrelevant to me. If I say it's going to happen, I believe it. I don't care if anybody else has thought of it. That doesn't mean I'm right. But I have a lot of self-confidence in myself and my talent and my, you know, my track record, if you will. My track record is there for all to, you know, see, measure, weigh, do whatever they want to with it. So I don't necessarily pay attention so much to what other people say. But the fact that these other schools of thought have also postulated that this is a possibility, does it sort of reinforce my confidence in it? It does. So that's my answer to that one.
And I know that I've kept you like a half hour longer than what we had planned, but this is my last question from the chat room. And this comes from Carrie Ann, and she asked, do people have a soulmate that they find sometimes from a past life?
I believe you have lots of soulmates. Now, a soulmate, we tend to think of soulmates in the romantic, oh, my soulmate, my twin flame, my knight in shining armor, my damsel and, you know, Rapunzel that's there for me. I mean, whatever that romantic image is, I believe we have lots of soulmates. And there's an old adage, be careful if you meet your soulmate because they can kill you. They can change you. So what exactly is a soulmate? A soulmate is someone who comes into your life who helps you transform. Sometimes they can transform through benevolence. Sometimes they can transform through chaos. You might meet someone, and they're just like hell on wheels to you. But the way that you respond to them and the changes you make within your life and yourself, you may find that they're the greatest thing to happen to you. That might be your soulmate, even though they came in the form of somebody that was like an enemy to you. Or a relationship, a star-crossed lover kind of relationship, any number of different things. Again, it goes back to what I was saying earlier about, can I look at two charts and say if I see what I believe is a karmic connection or certainly a... when I talk about people being on the same wavelength, I mean that in a literal sense, like in a quantum mechanics kind of way. I do believe that there are people who are in harmonic relationships with others, and I do believe there are people that are totally in dissonant relationships with each other, that we're like, you know, fingers on a chalkboard to each other. And I think there is an energy pattern that you can measure. You can certainly, I can see it and feel it. And I'm sure I'm not the only one that can see and feel it. Do I think there's like that one perfect relationship for everyone? It may not be part of your learning process. You may have said to yourself, I'm going to forego that because I want to work on these other things. You know, I need this other type of experience, and I'm willing to have that. And so, you know, do we all kind of look for it? I think, truthfully, everybody looks for that. I don't know that everybody finds it. And I'm not convinced that everybody should find it. But that doesn't take away the fact that I think most of us would like to find it. So I hope that answers that question. And I'm trying to be, like, more brief now. I'm trying to get, you know, faster.
Yeah, I understand. And, you know, I have just been blown away tonight. I want to say thank you, Andrew, for coming to my humble home and spending this hour and 34 minutes with us. It has been eye-opening. And I hope you'll agree to come back. I hope I haven't scared you.
It's fun. I love to talk. I'm a ham. People listen to me. Life is good. You know, what couldn't be any better.
How about telling people where they can find you, your Facebook, and also your website? I've been throwing it in here in the chat room, but for the people that get the replays, they won't see that. So go ahead and give some...
It's andrew-brewer.com, A-N-D-R-E-W-B-R-E-W-E-R, andrewbrewer.com. On Facebook, it's andrew-brewer. I'm on Facebook, and I have a public page, so, you know, everybody can kind of hang out and do whatever. So those are the best ways to find me.
Okay, and again, I want to say thank you so very much. I have really enjoyed it. I've been looking forward to spending this time with you. Yeah, and I look forward to doing it again, because you've actually become one of my favorite guests.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. As you know, as a radio personality, there's a dynamic that happens. Sometimes you enjoy it, and sometimes you're like, oh my God, will it ever end? You know, and I've really had fun. I mean, this has flown by for me. I've had a really good time. You were a lot of fun. You were very polite. I mean, it's been energetically a happy experience for me. I would love to do it again, of course.
And
there's others, but I wouldn't say that.
My professionalism, let's not forget about that.
I mean, you're very professional. It's obvious that you've done it in the past. I mean, I don't have to be a psychic to see that, so thank you.
Thank you. Remember, it was your world. We just lived in it. I want to thank everybody for tuning in this evening. This has been Let's Talk. And until next week, all remember, Monday or Friday night, I do the 70s ballroom. Proving once again, you don't need a social life to have someplace cool to go on Friday night.
That's fantastic.
And that starts at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time right here at this same station. But until next week, ladies and gentlemen, I want to wish you all, including Andrew, many pleasant nightmares. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Stop this.